when you think about evidence-based service planning, what it is that it's a focused, assessment-driven, and science-informed approach, and there's certain priorities that you utilize. And even if you're not doing the interventions yourself, when you're thinking about them and helping find these interventions, you should have these in mind. So does somebody want to read the first one? Effectiveness and efficiency.
Not all services are equal.
I mean, you can read it too. Start with the first one. But so for example, they talk about not all services are equal, right? And some are more effective than others. And usually when you're planning interventions, you want to favor those who have some type of evidence supporting them. So in this case, we mentioned this already, that it looks like there's no psychological interventions addressing kind of some of the behavioral issues. Right, there's some that get at the trauma, which is great. I think that's awesome. But we have to, one, find the intervention that addresses the issues, and then two, hopefully use an intervention that has some evidence that it works with families. So if with this family, they're going in there because of domestic violence-related issues and child abuse, your intervention has to have some kind of effectiveness related to that. So that's just one thing that I think that you have to start off with. So it's effectiveness and efficiency. The second one is focus and parsimony. And I think you guys struggle with this like Los Angeles struggles with this. Because what happens is when we see a family with a lot of problems, what do we want to do? We want to give them everything, right? It's like we want to give them parenting classes, and then we want to give them child development, and then we want to give them therapy. Then there's sports and networking, and then in your case it looks like the horseback riding. So we're giving them. And what do you think happens with these families when you overwhelm them with services? It's difficult, right? It becomes overwhelming, and sometimes we talk about how you can set up a family to fail if you give them too much to do. So I'll give you an example here. Oftentimes the families that we work with that are poor, and this was something that came up in a place, this was more in San Francisco, but when they go to get services, they don't have a car, so oftentimes they have to take public transportation. And I don't know if you're aware of this, but in California, public transportation is not as efficient as the Austrian system. So you guys have buses and trains that run on time, right, and they're reliable.
Yes.
This is the case, especially in your areas. But in Los Angeles, sometimes you'll have to wait around for a bus for an hour, right? And that's if there's a close bus stop. Sometimes you'll walk 15 to 30 minutes to a bus stop, depending on where you live. You have to take it to your one service provider. That's one service. If you do give a family two, three services, that's another bus, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then if you add on to that doctor's appointments, just basic stuff, that's another bus. So this is where, actually going back to what somebody said about mobile workers, where a lot of that has been growing, because it's with these families where you bring the services to them. Okay?
All right.
So that's one point. But I really want you to think about what is the smallest number of services that will accomplish the intended goal, right?
So that would be the second step thinking, right? To figure out the smallest number of services.
Does that make sense?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Now we have this green, okay.
Maximum impact? So how would you say that? Maximum impact
or
the minimum amount of services?
Right.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
Yes.
But it's not too easy to measure it.